Books on Tape presents A Century of Great Suspense Stories, Volume 1, edited by Jeffery Deaver.
The Gentleman in the Lake by Robert Barnard. Copyright 1994 by Robert Barnard. Read by Richard Matthews. Among the writers I admire most are Christie, Allingham, Rendell, and Margaret Miller, Robert Barnard once noted. Perhaps this is why his own voice is that of a pure detective writer. Whatever else a given Barnard novel may offer, humour, keen social observation, place description that is genuinely poetic, his novels and stories always remain focused on the mystery. While one hates to speculate on which writers of our time will be read by future generations, Barnard, with his grace, intelligence, and enormous range of skills, is certainly a likely contender. Death of an Old Goat, 1977, Bodies, 1986, and A City of Strangers are among his many worthwhile novels, with his latest including Unholy Dying. The Gentleman in the Lake by Robert Barnard. There had been violent storms that night, but the body did not come to the surface until they had died down, and a watery summer sun sent ripples of lemon and silver across the still disturbed surface of Derwent Water. It was first seen by a little girl, clutching a plastic beaker of orange juice, who had strayed down from the small car park over the pebbles to the edge of the lake.
"What's that, Mummy?"
"What's what, dear?" Her mother was wandering round, drinking in the calm, the silence, the magisterial beauty, the more potent for the absence of other tourists. She was a businesswoman, and holidays by the lakes made her question uncomfortably what she was doing with her life. She strolled down to where the water lapped onto the stones.
"There, Mummy, that!"
She looked towards the lake. A sort of bundle bobbed on the surface 100 yards or so away. She screwed up her eyes. A sort of tweedy bundle. Greeny-brown, like an old-fashioned gentleman's suit. As she watched, she realized that she could make out, stretching out from the bundle, two lines. Legs. She put her hand firmly on her daughter's shoulder.
"Oh, it's just an old bundle of clothes, darling. Look, there's Patch wanting to play. He has to stretch his legs too, you know."
Patch barked obligingly, and the little girl trotted off to throw his ball for him. Without hurrying, the woman made her way back to the car, picked up the car phone, and dialed 999. It was late on in the previous summer that Marcia Catchpole had sat beside Sir James Harrington at a dinner party in St. John's Wood.
"Something immensely distinguished in law,"
her hostess, Serena Fisk, had told her vaguely.
"Not a judge, but rather famous defending counsel, or prosecuting counsel, or something of that sort."
He had been rather quiet as they all sat down, urbane, courteous in a dated sort of way, but quiet. It was as if he was far away, reviewing the finer points of a case long ago.
"So nice to have soup," said Marcia, famous for drawing people out, especially men. "Soup seems almost to have gone out these days."
"Really?"
said Sir James, as if they were discussing the habits of Eskimos or Trobriand Islanders.
"Yes. I suppose you don't often get it."
"No, it's all melons and ham and pâté and seafood cocktails."
"Is it? Is it?"
His concentration wavering, he returned to his soup, which he was consuming a good deal more expertly than Marcia, who, truth to tell, was more used to melons and such like.
"You don't eat out a great deal?"
"No, not now. Once, when I was practising, but not now, and not since my wife died."
"Of course you're right. People don't like singles, do they?"
"Singles?"
"People on their own, for dinner parties. They have to find another one, like me tonight."
"Yes. Yes,"
he said, as if only half understanding what she said.
"And it's no fun eating in a restaurant on your own, is it?"
"No. None at all. I have a woman come in," he added, as if trying to make a contribution of his own.
"To cook and clean for you?"
"Yes. Perfectly capable woman. It's not the same, though."
"No, nothing is it, when you find yourself on your own?"
"No, it's not."
he thought as if thought was difficult.
"You can't do so many things you used to do."
"Ah, you find that too, do you? What do you miss most?" There was a moment's silence, as if he had forgotten what they were talking about. Then he said,
"Travel. I'd like to go to the lakes again."
"Oh, the lakes! One of my favourite places. Don't you drive?"
"No, I've never had any need before."
"Do you have children?"
"Oh, yes. 2 sons. One in medicine, one in politics. Busy chaps, with families of their own. Can't expect them to take me places. Don't see much of them."
His moment of animation seemed to fade, and he picked away at his entree.
"What is this fish, Molly?"
When, the next day, she phoned to thank her hostess, Marcia commented that Sir James was such a sweetie.
"You and he seemed to get on like a house on fire, anyway."
"Oh, we did.
Other people said he was awfully vague."
"Oh, it's the legal mind, wrapped in grand generalities. His wife been dead long?"
"About 2 years. I believe he misses her frightfully. Molly used to arrange all the practicalities for him."
"I can believe that. I was supposed to ring him about a book I have that he wanted, but he forgot to give me his number."
"Oh, it's 271876, a rather grand place in Chelsea."
But Marcia had already guessed the number after going through the telephone directory. She had also guessed at the name of Sir James's late wife.
"We can't do much till we have the pathologist's report," said Superintendent Southern, fingering the still-damp material of a tweed suit, "except perhaps about this."
Sergeant Potter looked down at it.
"I don't know a lot about such things," he said, "but I'd have said that suit was dear."
"So would I. A gentleman's suit made to measure and beautifully sewn. I've had one of the secretaries in who knows about these things. A gentleman's suit for country wear, made for a man who doesn't know the meaning of the word casual, with a name tag sewn in by the tailor and crudely removed, with a razor blade, probably."
"You don't get razor blades much these days."
"Perhaps he's also someone who doesn't know the meaning of the word throwaway. A picture seems to be emerging."
"And the removal of the name tag almost inevitably means..."
"Murder. Yes, I'd say so."
Marcia decided against ringing Sir James up. She felt sure he would not remember who she was. Instead, she would call round with the book, which had indeed come up in conversation, because she had made sure it did. Marcia was very good at fostering acquaintanceships with men, and had had 2 moderately lucrative divorces to prove it. She timed her visit for late afternoon, when she calculated that the lady who cooked and did for him would have gone home. When he opened the door, he blinked, and his hand strayed towards his lips.
"I'm afraid I..."
"Marcia Catchpole. We met at Serena Fisk's. I brought the book on Wordsworth we were talking about." She proffered Stephen Gill on Wordsworth in paperback. She had thought, as she bought it, that Sir James was probably not used to paperbacks, but she decided that, as an investment, Sir James was not yet worth the price of a hardback.
"Oh, I don't... won't you come in?"
"Lovely." She was taken into a rather grim sitting-room, lined with legal books and Victorian first editions. Sir James began to make uncertain remarks about how he thought he could manage tea.
"Why don't you let me make it? You'll not be used to fending for yourself, let alone for visitors. It was different in your generation, wasn't it? Is that the kitchen?"
And she immediately showed an uncanny instinct for finding things and doing the necessary. Sir James watched her, bemused, for a minute or two, then shuffled back to the sitting-room. When she came in with a tray, with tea things on it and a plate of biscuits, he looked as if he had forgotten who she was and how she came to be there.
"There, that's nice, isn't it? Do you like it strong?" "Not too strong, right? I think you'll enjoy the Wordsworth book. Wordsworth really is the lakes, don't you agree?"
She had formed the notion, when talking to him at Serena Fisk's dinner party, that his reading was remaining with him longer than his grip on real life. This was confirmed by the conversation on this visit. As long as the talk stayed with Wordsworth and his Lakeland circle, it approached a normal chat. He would forget the names of poems, but he would sometimes quote several lines of the better-known ones verbatim. Marcia had been educated at a moderately good state school, and she managed to keep her end up. Marcia got up to go just at the right time, when Sir James had got used to her being there, and before he began wanting her to go. At the door she said,
"I'm expecting to have to go to the lakes on business in a couple of weeks. I'd be happy if you'd come along."
Oh, I couldn't possibly.
No obligations either way. We pay for ourselves. Separate rooms, of course. Quite independent of each other. I've got business in Cockermouth, and I thought of staying by Buttermere or Crummock Water. A glint came into his eyes.
It would be wonderful to see them again, but I really couldn't.
Of course you could. It would be my pleasure.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.